Well, good evening. Thank you, Catherine and Dean Rutherford. And it's a real honor to be here with all of you here tonight. We just had a great conversation with some of the AmeriCorps alums who attend the Clinton School and some who have just graduated. And so before I begin, I'd just like to kind of get a show of hands. How many AmeriCorps alums do we have in the room? We have wow, it's a good number. Congratulations. Thank you for serving. How many of you had served in VISTA as a VISTA volunteer? Like, okay, we have some. Thank you for serving in VISTA. What about folks who have served in the Peace Corps? We have some Peace Corps alums here. How about those who have served our country in National Military Service? Some veterans, thank you for your service to our country. And this one, I think all the hands should go up. How many in this room volunteer and serve and make contributions to their community or have done it? Thank you, too. This is a special place, for me because I see a lot of Arkansas leadership here in National Service. I want to introduce some of my colleagues that I work with here and have worked with in the past. You know, National Service, when the legislation was designed by President Clinton, it had a strong role for governors. Governors were to be a key ingredient for National Service, and the reason for that is, as a governor, he saw the important role that individuals in the highest elected office should have to create and shape what National Service should be. And so they created something called state commissions for National Service, where the governor would appoint the commissioners, and the commissioners would act as, if you will, as a board of directors. And so in every state around the country, we have state commissions on service. And I see Will Rorick there. Will is the director of the Arkansas Commission. And next to him is Al Schneider, a good friend who I've worked with, former chair or former director of the Arkansas Commission. Opal Sims sitting next to Will. Opal is the director of our corporation state office that's responsible for AmeriCorps VISTA and the Senior Corps programs. And so there's a large number of folks who make this work. But at the end of the day, it was President Clinton who had some interesting kind of perspectives on how National Service should go forward. And part of that is, and what made it unique, I think, was this whole idea of an education award. You know, after you served, you would earn an education award that could be used to pay for tuition. It could be used to repay a student loan. And if you think back in 1993, I don't think we thought much about what student loan debt was. I mean, today it's $1.2 trillion, if you can kind of figure out what that number is. But back then, it was just, I don't know, it was put into the law, and thank goodness it stayed, because I think it also helps address this whole loan indebtedness issue in some small way, but a very important way. And so this idea of connecting service to future education was a theme that the president, candidate Clinton, Governor Clinton, had. It was a theme that he articulated throughout the campaign trail. In fact, it was a major piece of AmeriCorps. And so the legislation was passed, and if you go to the Clinton Library right next to us, I would just call your attention to the president's schedule for September 21st of 1993. You'll see at the top of the schedule the morning jog, and then through the day and in the early afternoon it was something called the AmeriCorps ceremony. And the staff lead on that was, as Dean Weatherford said, was Eli Siegel. And Eli was the leader of putting this National Service program not only together, but implementing the first parts of it. And so September 21st, 93 is when the president signed into law the National Service Bill. And then if you were to look at another part of the presidential calendar next door, September 12th, 1994 was when the first AmeriCorps members began. And so that day was to be planned as a big day of celebration. And so what happened on September 12th was another part of notoriety that's connected with AmeriCorps when that small plane crashed into the White House. And so the ceremony that had been planned for 1,000 people, 6 hours later, amounted to a group of AmeriCorps members standing around the president in the Oval Office taking the oath of service. And so it's interesting how times have changed, and sometimes maybe they haven't changed, but September 12th. And so this is a special time to be here because September 12th of 2014 is our 20th anniversary. And obviously those of you who might have been here September 12th, just a week and a half ago, know of it. And we'll talk about that a little bit, about the significance of it. In 20 years, what has happened? It's amazing what has happened. I was talking to President Clinton about 6 weeks ago about this ceremony, and we were talking about, you know, where he should be, at the library here, at the Clinton School, or in Washington. He said, "I will go wherever the president wants me to go." And his eyes lit up when we talked about AmeriCorps and the 900,000 folks who had served. He said it was well beyond what they had originally envisioned. And so the lesson I would just share is persistence. And it wasn't an easy path. Those of you who maybe followed this, there were many times during President Clinton's administration when the budget from the House would come back zero. And the stories, Dean Rutherford can fill us in on some of the inner stories, but there are urban legends now probably, but what had to be done to make those trade-offs to get AmeriCorps funded, because Congress knew that President Clinton wanted this funded. And Mrs. Clinton played a huge role in ensuring that the funding would be there. And so it was an interesting dynamic how this national service program was birthed, but then who carried it forward? And so a lot of folks had a part in that. What I wanna do tonight is do a couple things. We're gonna do a quick, about 5 or 10 slides here, and talk about what AmeriCorps is about, some of the changes that have taken place over the years. I'm gonna show a short video. It's about a 4-minute video, and it's kind of a summary of what took place a week and a half ago around the country. Now, in the video, there's a couple places where you can win a prize. So here are the things you need to watch for when we go into the video. How many presidents are featured in the video? It is a trick question, but I can see many of you are presidential scholars, so you'll figure this out. So anyone that gets it, how many presidents are featured? The next part of the video, and this is to see if you're really paying attention, what does President George H.W. Bush have on his right foot? So I'll give you a hint on that. If you have to watch for it, but it is there. It's taken at Walker's Point in Maine a week and a half ago. And so those are kind of the two things that, if you can follow in the video, but I think it does present what took place, and you'll see kind of a snippet of what took place here in Arkansas and in other parts of the country. Another thing to cue up in the video is that we decided that it would make sense to do the swearing-in ceremony. It's kind of like behind the scenes of how you put something together or not put something together. We thought it made sense if we did the swearing in at the same time, consecutively, all over the country. We didn't, in our external affairs office, they didn't calculate what time it would be in Guam, in the Northern Marianas, let alone Hawaii or Alaska. And so when the White House gave us the time of 11:30 Eastern, our jaws just dropped. We thought, oh my goodness, what are they thinking? But it was great. They wanted to do it and have 1,000 folks on the South Lawn. But what that meant was that I think it unified this effort. Because in Guam and the Marianas, we have 140 AmeriCorps members serving. Their ceremony to be part of this whole event began at 1:30 in the morning on Saturday. The following day, because of the international day. So they started their ceremony at 1:30 in the morning. So they never went to bed. They stayed up all Friday night and into Saturday morning. In Hawaii, it was a great experience because they started their event at 5:30 in the morning. And their idea was that who else would be up and what other feature would be on the news that morning? I mean, this is live TV, so who else would be around? And so people saw what initially was maybe adversity, having to get up in the middle of the night. And every state, and you'll see snippets of this, every state had a ceremony going on And at 11:30 in all the time zones from the White House, we began. And everyone took the oath of service at the same time, in every state, all over the country. And I think that, I think it was moving to President Clinton as he saw it. And we'll see what your reactions are after you see the video. So you'll see snippets from all over the country about what this meant, and some little snippets from various presidents. The other thing that you'll notice in the video is that we have presidents of different parties agreeing on something. So if you'll notice that it's the bipartisanship presidentially that we have for national service. And the challenge that we have to work at is the bipartisanship in the House and to some degree in the Senate. But it's kind of interesting to see what four presidents did and said during that day. So we will begin, if we can make this work, and run through a couple. So so this is some of the data that we've been putting out in terms of who serves over the last 20 years. 900,000 AmeriCorps members. When I told President Clinton that, he was just stunned, and I think most people are. That is a huge number. They generated 4 million volunteers. What that means is those AmeriCorps members in the projects where they were doing volunteer generation recruited 4 million individuals to serve the country. During that time, we had 315,000 volunteers in the Senior Corps, 60,000 locations, $830 million generated in philanthropic resources. And at the bottom, there's 1,760 mayors. We have something called the Mayor's Day of Recognition for National Service. And Mayor Stodola here in Little Rock is a big champion of that. Mayors from all over the country this past spring have stood up and talked about what service means to their city. So these are the presidents. You'll see them. I said there were five. I mean, there are five. The goal is to find the fifth. And these presidents all participated in our day on September 12th. One of the ways that we're looking at expanding national service is through a task force President Obama created last summer, and it's to partner with other federal agencies to help them do their work through AmeriCorps. One of the premier examples is with FEMA. You'll see that little picture there of destruction. I think that's from Joplin. And basically what FEMA felt was that if they could provide funding to expand the number of AmeriCorps members, those AmeriCorps members could be immediately deployed to areas where we have this massive destruction and where we have a high need, but we need a core of folks who can be deployed rapidly. So just for example, our last big disaster, 2 years anniversary at the end of this month, Hurricane Sandy, we had 3,200 individuals, 3,200 AmeriCorps members deployed from all over the country to respond to Hurricane Sandy. And it was kind of a response unlike we had ever seen before, because we sent members to do one thing, and in the middle of their trip across the country, they were told to do something else. So it was quite, we had training on the spot, training in vans, training just in time. But here's the interesting point. In Hurricane Sandy, the folks who needed our help were our most vulnerable citizens. What had happened during Hurricane Sandy is a lot of the individuals in care facilities, especially Alzheimer's patients, those facilities were flooded out, the power was out, and their care people left or couldn't find them, and those folks had to be moved to temporary shelters. And FEMA came to us and said, the people we would trust the most are your AmeriCorps members to care for these folks with Alzheimer's. And that's what they did. We had large numbers of AmeriCorps members who, for the first 2 weeks of Hurricane Sandy in New York especially, were staffing these shelters 24/7. And so it was, in one sense, we were there to put, you know, the blue tarps on the houses. In another sense, we were called to do something better. And I think any AmeriCorps member who was doing that day, and it was 24/7 those days, walking with Alzheimer's patients up and down the hall, because we had taken them out of something that they knew into something they didn't know. but it was AmeriCorps members who really saved the day. Okay, these partnership challenges, we're looking at ways where we can build something called the AmeriCorps partnership. It's something that's new, that's just been announced, and we're in the midst of building it. And what it means is that we're providing the, if you will, the education awards, you know, the scholarships to AmeriCorps members, to those organizations that can generate the funding, whether it's public or private. And so we've offered up close to $30 million of education awards, and we will match that with organizations that want to come forward and provide the funding to support AmeriCorps members. So it's kind of a different way of extending our reach, but we're having some interesting responses and reactions. Operation AmeriCorps, kind of a new partnership with us that's going on right now. What we're trying to do is package, if you will, all of the resources that we have, both AmeriCorps and VISTA, the Senior Corps and NCCC, as a way to help communities address some kind of chronic issue. So if it's trying to get every student to graduate from high school, that would be one way we would deploy those initiatives, and that effort is going on right now. And employers of national service. President Obama announced this at the 20th anniversary event, and we are working aggressively now with a number of corporations, the ones who are listed there, and there are many others that will be coming on board, corporations who will want to hire individuals who have served either in the Peace Corps or AmeriCorps. And what we're asking those companies to do is something as simple as putting a checkbox on their application. Did you ever serve in AmeriCorps or Peace Corps? Or a question, describe any national service experience you've had. Because we're finding employers who are looking for folks who can think on their feet, that have a sense of a customer understanding, a sense of compassion, who can work with minimal direction and supervision, who can think outside the box, who maybe don't even have to box to think out of. Those are the folks that companies are looking for, and so we want to partner up. So we're going to have a major announcement with those companies and those nonprofit organizations to do it. Just to give one example, Habitat. They're close to I think almost a third, almost maybe a little bit more of their employees are former AmeriCorps members. And so these are the folks Habitat hires to actually run the Habitat projects, to recruit individuals to volunteer, to generate the funding, to do the loan processing. It's a big operation, and so they see the value there. I don't know if you're gonna be able to see this very well, but I wanted, the bottom number is where we'll kind of focus. The idea here is that we have, I just wanted to show what takes place in a state. So we call this, Arkansas, it can be any state at a glance, this is on our website, but you'll see that the total support that comes into Arkansas from 13 and 14 is about 12.2 million, and that includes funding that comes from a number of resources. So it's not just the AmeriCorps side of the house, but it's the Senior Corps, the foster grandparent, senior companion, and one of the things that I think is kind of fascinating to a lot of folks is we call it educational scholarships here. These are the education awards. So just in last year in Arkansas, it's almost $2 million that we put into the educational trust that supports individuals who served in this state in terms of the education awards. So it's just kind of one of those pieces of information. I don't think, as I said earlier, that maybe folks didn't know the value of what that would be, and now it's pretty significant. 20 years in AmeriCorps in Arkansas, what is that generated? So about 8,000 folks served in AmeriCorps over those 20 years, 13 million hours of service, and a total of 24 million in Ed Awards over those last 20 years. So it's pretty significant in terms of what AmeriCorps looks like in Arkansas. And for those that want to kind of figure out in other states, we can kind of figure that out for you too. So what we want to do now is maybe is to show the video. And we can kind of cue that up. So this is a 4-minute video. It's a summary of what we experienced about a week and a half ago, and it'll be some music, and then the sound comes in about two-thirds of the way through. And the goal here is obviously to watch it, but the five presidents, and what is President Bush wearing on his right foot?
Till my last day on earth, I will be grateful that I had a chance to start AmeriCorps.
More than 900,000 people have served during the last 20 years. As impressive as that number is, the accomplishments behind it are even greater. AmeriCorps members built homes, helped veterans and their families, and got kids in school and back on track for a better life.
To all who served, George and I send our gratitude. Those of you beginning your service, thank you for the commitment you're making to our country, and may God bless you.
Because like all those who serve their country through AmeriCorps, they don't just believe in, but live out a fundamental truth, and that is that people who love their country can change it. That is the genius of America. That is the promise of AmeriCorps. It's one of the reasons I am so committed to this program and why I'm so hopeful about the future.
So that is a quick summary of what took place about a week and a half ago. So who can name the five presidents? Who is the fifth president?
Lincoln.
All right, you got it. So how did President Lincoln get involved in this, you might wonder? He's a supporter of AmeriCorps. There was an event that took place at another presidential library in Springfield, Lincoln. President Lincoln has always been part of the AmeriCorps kickoff ceremony in the state of Illinois. And so what a better place to have President Lincoln than at the 20th anniversary, and if we could only live as long as President Lincoln did in that photo. But that's one thing. And then So you saw a photo of Neil Bush, President Bush's son, administering the oath of service at Walker Point in Kennebunkport, Maine. Did anyone get a chance to see what President George H.W. Bush had on his right foot? AmeriCorps socks, exactly. It's an interesting story. You know, President Bush, it's interesting, it's great he's here because he created and passed the act that created the Commission on National Service. It was a law signed and passed in 1990. And so it created the runway, if you will. It created the opportunity for folks like Eli Siegel and others who came on with President Clinton to have an office already in the executive office of the president that was thinking about this and figuring out how to make it work and how to put something together. So President Bush was very, very interested in this whole idea of service to country. And so when we found out that he indeed wanted to host these 10 AmeriCorps members, and it's very difficult for him to speak these days, but he wanted to be there. And so a person in our office thought, well, maybe he should have some AmeriCorps socks, because if you follow him, he likes these kind of outrageous socks to wear. So we sent those socks up, and we were just, I guess, surprised to see the AmeriCorps sock on there. So anyway, but it shows the extent, if you will, of the presidential support to the work that you do, and we thought it was pretty gratifying. So I don't think it would be right just to close, but without offering some challenges and some things that I think that we all have to deal with these days, days of, if you will, in some ways declining resources, but also maybe days when we don't have those big thoughts. We don't figure out a way maybe that we should go to the moon. We don't have that big goal in front of us. And so I'm going to throw out about two or three big goals for national service that I think are appropriate for an academic setting. They will be things that hopefully will, maybe someone will take a look at, but it will be somewhat different than, well, how can we get more funding? I think there's some more profound kind of work yet to be done, and I think that organizations that would want to partner with us and academic institutions that would want to partner with us could help move the country forward. So the three bold kind of initiatives that I would suggest that this esteemed body and this institution of higher education maybe think about and address. One would be the degree to which we can assist in higher education AmeriCorps programs who are struggling with showing how they work and why they produce the outcomes that they do. You know, Congress right now, it's the General Accounting Office, Congress, the OMB, every federal agency now has to be able to prove the work that they do is cost effective. Does this program work, and why does it work? And what kind of evidence-informed pieces of work are you doing? What does your research model and research design look like? And so when President Clinton created AmeriCorps, we weren't at that place yet. It was enough to be able to present outputs, you know, number of volunteers generated, number of meals served to the homeless, number of children tutored. I mean, that's the kind of information we collected, and it was important information. We have moved now to a place on the continuum where we have to justify those number of children that were tutored. It's not enough to be able to say that we tutored 500 or 5,000 or 5 million children. What happened to those children? How did you raise their reading level? Did you enable those children to stay in school and graduate on time? And so this issue is a tricky one, because I think many of our smaller AmeriCorps programs have a difficult time figuring out how to put a research design together. And what is good research? What does it look like? What does it mean to be evidence-informed or evidence-based? I was sharing with the alums just a minute ago, and I met with about 15 of the largest environmental restoration AmeriCorps programs in the country yesterday. And so the question we were wrestling with is, how do you show progress? How do you show outcomes in an environmental restoration activity? So for instance, with the Arkansas River right out here, if we had a team of 50 AmeriCorps members who were addressing, if you will, non-point sources of pollution, pollution that flows into the Arkansas River from whether it's farming or landowners who use too much pesticides or whatever, how do we measure? How would we go about building a research design, and how would we show that information quickly? We have a very, our attention span for research is very limited. We want to see the change tomorrow. We want to see the change in the next fiscal year. The next time you have a budget, we want that justified. So how do we work with that tension where, on the one hand, the Congress wants to see more outcomes and demonstrated outcomes, and we have organizations that are, many of them, not up to par to build that quality research design? So I would say to an academic institution, and especially to this one, that might be a project to take on, is to help figure out, maybe just in Arkansas, or it could be a whole region in the Southeast, how do we build and help folks determine what is good research? How do we help them demonstrate that what they know, that it's a good program? But anecdotally, and the stories that relate from that, is not good enough anymore. But I think that's where higher education can step in, and that's where I think individuals who have a passion for service can see that and can help organizations figure this out. That's number one. Number two, when the National Community Service Trust Act was passed and signed into law by President Clinton in 93, I mean, the world was a different place. You can imagine it was a world that just began to understand something called the internet. We sent, if you will, our first progress reports, Al shaking his head back there, to the Corporation for National Service in big envelopes and multiple copies, as only the government could have, you know, 20 copies or something. And we never knew, I mean, who would have thought it would change? And the change was like that. And so when the law was passed, we initially, we never thought that, if you will, veterans would serve in AmeriCorps. When the National Service Law was passed in 2009, there was a Veterans Corps created. It was a different country. We were in the midst of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Veterans are coming home, and now veterans coming back at roughly 200,000 a year. Many not to see any employment opportunities. And so we've created in certain locations Veterans Corps opportunities where vets can serve other vets. One of the most heartening, I think, experiences is to see veterans who maybe never thought they could serve the country or serve a buddy again, be in a higher institution, institution of higher education, and assist other veterans navigate the GI Bill process. If you don't know, I mean, it's a huge issue that education and VA deal with today, is the high numbers of folks who don't complete the GI Bill. And for many veterans, they have to pay most of that money back. Oftentimes, it's because of poor decisions or decisions that weren't made with the full knowledge of what was going on. Obviously, some of this is with proprietary schools. There's a whole lot of issues going on here. But having something as simple as one veteran helping another veteran makes a difference. Having a veteran engaged and involved in disaster response oftentimes is therapeutic. I know from personal experience working with veterans who are coping with post-traumatic stress, who the VA said they're 40% disabled, who when given an opportunity to assist other veterans, their doctors, their physicians wonder what happened to them. All kinds of things have changed. And so I would contend that the next frontier, one of the next frontiers for national services, is for us to partner with our colleagues in the healthcare system, neurologists and others, because I think brain research is the next frontier for national service. If a sustained amount of volunteerism can be sustained by an individual, Does that allow the brain to regenerate? Does that allow the brain to reform because of a traumatic event that someone had before them, and now they're doing something totally different? We're changing the dynamic. Instead of someone being viewed as a patient or a client, they're viewed as someone with talent, someone that can make a contribution. And so in talking to many soldiers, this whole experience is life-changing. Because the VA experience, not to dump on the VA, but the VA experience is one where you are a patient. We will care for you, but we won't engage you. We will not, we believe that you've already served. You don't need to serve again. But that's exactly what a lot of folks are looking for, that opportunity to be reconnected with their community and their country. They want to take that training to the next level. They want to be involved in rebuilding their community. And so I saw on Hurricane Sandy, members who were in the National Guard, who were AmeriCorps leaders, be deferred to by New Jersey officials because they knew what it took to be in communities that basically were wiped out. They were the only ones that could put it together. They were the ones that saw resources when other people saw problems. We had a National Guard veteran who was in a particular area and saw a busload of students come. And for a lot of folks in disaster management, that's the worst thing you want to see, people who want to help out. All I can see is liability. He saw potential, and he found jobs for that day, for that entire school bus of kids. What do you think that did for them? It empowered them, but more importantly, other people, people in the New Jersey State Police and others saw, my goodness, you're pretty good at putting stuff together. And so they deferred to him on how we engage citizens in rebuilding their community. And so I think that looking in a different way, and I think that perhaps partnering with your other partners in higher education, say at the University of Arkansas Health Systems, people who are studying brain research, what would happen if a steady exposure to volunteerism and service would stop the onset of Alzheimer's or dementia? It is work that we do. It's work that we own. But oftentimes we're looked at as an organization and they give you a pat on the back. Isn't that nice what they're doing? I think there is a higher calling for this work. And I would hope that there would be some interest to look at ways that in brain science and brain research, does the act of volunteering stimulate the brain enough to cause positive permanent change? Lastly, I want to leave you with this challenge because it's been written about some, it's desperately needed, and it's something that I think that we can attain. We all know the divisions that keep our country apart, and it's pretty easy. We have shorthand to define it. Red or blue, faith or unfaith, black and white, rich and poor. And that divides us. But what brings us together, and when do we come together? Unfortunately, in a way, we come together in these disasters. Why is it that we have to wait for a calamity to occur when we will come together, when who you are and what you believe and where you're from doesn't matter? I mean, we saw that in the recovery with Hurricane Katrina. We had folks from all over serving and working together, sweating together, eating together, sleeping in church basements. Didn't matter. We were all there united for one single purpose, to help people affected by this terrible disaster to recover. So why do we have to wait until something like that happens? So I contend that this service to nation, this bringing together around a common purpose helps unify us, helps us unify a purpose. So how do we prove it? So that's the challenge. Does service to nation, and how does it help unify? Does it truly bring people together? Or does it bring them together for one moment in time and then they disappear? I don't think that if you're affected by working in one of these disasters, or you're serving in a school, or you're doing something that makes a positive contribution, that lasts a lifetime. And that then enables us to have courageous conversations with others who are not like us, or maybe it's an R or a D, a red or a blue, it doesn't make a whole lot of difference when we're standing side by side rebuilding the nation, rebuilding a school, rebuilding a community. And so I would leave you with that. It is kind of a third challenge, and that is, does national service, does AmeriCorps, is it something that can unify us as a country? Can it bring out a higher calling in others? Can we put aside the labels? Does it inspire us to do better? I think it does. I see it every day. When those of you raised your hand and you said you served in AmeriCorps or VISTA or you were a veteran or you served the country, there's something about you that that other people admire. I've told the story before. I've been accused of stalking AmeriCorps members on the Metro in Washington, D.C., and I admit to doing it. I am attracted by that A, and so if I can slither in the subway door before it closes, I work my way up to where the AmeriCorps member is sitting or standing and say to them, thank you for serving. You're an AmeriCorps member, right? And then the next question is, well, how do you know? Well, kind of that A kind of gives it away, or that red jacket gives it away. But and then we talk about this experience, and it's interesting to see the other people leaning in on the conversation, because the next question I ask is, how was your day? How was it different? What did you do to affect change in the school or the community setting that or center where you were? And everyone wants to hear that. People are starved to hear what we do and how we do it, and that we're actually making progress. I mean, that's the fascinating thing about it. People want to do this. People admire all of you in this room who said that you volunteer. And now the question is, how do we bring those folks together? And then can we figure out a way to sustain this? So it's not something about a country that has different factions in different regions, but when we get together and serve each other, it brings out the best in all of us. So those are the three challenges I leave with not only the Clinton School, but all of higher education. I think there is much to do. I think where we go can be much higher, and what we do can be broader and deeper if we can tackle some of these bigger issues. And I think we're up for it. I'll leave you with one last initiative we're working on that you'll probably hear about in the news. You probably know about a number of children who are coming to the country, and it's not just the ones who have come in the last few months, but individuals who end up in immigration court. I don't know if you've ever been to an immigration court, but it's quite stark when you see 8, 9, 10-year-olds standing by themselves in front of a judge. Usually there's no one else around. Maybe they're fortunate every once in a while to have free counsel. But then someone has to tell the child through a translator about how their case is going to be disposed. We have no representation for those children. And so you'll be about to hear a partnership that we're going to have with the Department of Justice, where we're going to provide AmeriCorps members who are attorneys and paralegals who will provide legal representation for every child on the docket in immigration courts in selected cities around the country. This is not without controversy, as you can imagine. But I think what it says is that it's important for us to stand and stand beside and stand with those who have no one to stand with. I think it helps us bring the country closer together. We're not going to allow something to happen to an 8-year-old who had no course, no decision to make in this effort. But we're going to bring out the best in other Americans who will stand with them. And so I think that's the magic of national service. I don't know if President Clinton and Skip and Eli and others in 1992 ever imagined what this would turn into. But I know that what has happened in the last 20 years has been phenomenal. It is one of the biggest changes that took place in this whole area of service and volunteerism since the CCC, the Civilian Conservation Corps. And for those of you who have served in whatever capacity, all I can say is thank you from the bottom of our heart. Thank you for making those kinds of contributions. Thank you for supporting others who serve in national service. Thank you for standing for the best attributes of our country, and it's been an honor to be with you tonight. Thank you.
Thanks, Bill. We've got time for a couple of questions, and and wait for the microphone. We'll get right over to you.
I appreciate what you said about natural disasters. Yesterday at the State Floodplain Management Conference, I gave a presentation on cognitive floodplain management and had a chance to go to Joplin Monday. And so I guess what I'm curious is, are y'all looking at ways for post-traumatic growth or post-traumatic success studies? And may they be looking at neuroplasticity, especially dealing with like the prefrontal cortex and other parts of the brain that may deal with post-traumatic stress disorder.
Yep, and you're gonna lead our research. You got it. No, seriously, that is a path that we really need to go down. And I think it's something that most people wouldn't think about for volunteerism and service. But I think that is where some of our future lies. And I'm glad you're going to Joplin, because there is a city that totally gets what National Service meant to them. There's a park in Joplin that's basically dedicated to AmeriCorps members. Okay, great. Well, and you know, too, the story. I mean, the generation of the $17 million in match through volunteer efforts allowed Joplin to stay solvent. Because, you know, when FEMA comes in, you know, there's no free lunch. You have to come up with some match money. And that's what allowed Joplin to stay solvent, because they used volunteers during that disaster recovery. So it's good.
Yeah, I've got Andrew question right there.
Hi, my name is Andrew Forsman. I'm a graduate student here at the Clinton School.
Right.
So with your three challenges at the end, I was thinking about the first one. You're building an evaluation and a research into your efforts. And I actually have a research background, and you'd be looking at another AmeriCorps member, another AmeriCorps alumni, if y'all had an integrated area of AmeriCorps with research. So I'm thinking, I looked at AmeriCorps after college, actually, as kind of some career alternatives. And so I'm thinking, if you had some recruiting efforts into like STEM and research-based majors in college, you know, when you're out already doing your recruiting on college campuses, you know, maybe have like a separate thing you call Research Corps. So you can have, you know, different levels of it, bachelor students led by masters and PhDs and professionals, you know, coming in and saying, you know, we love research, we love evaluation, and we love service. And this is a great way for you to help out this organization and help out your country, and a great way for you to get research experience in addition as well. So maybe that's one idea when you're already out doing your recruiting, you know, to try and start targeting those majors.
That's an excellent idea. We're gonna follow up on that.
I also think another idea is the challenge that Andrew just raised about your first challenge of research. It would be a great capstone project for a Clinton School student to work with the Arkansas Office of Community Service and to develop a model that could be positioned all around the country to develop a working template and model. So students meet Arkansas. This is a really possibility that could have national implications. Mm-hmm. So nothing more endorsement than that, but I just think that's a really good idea, even though if it was his. Any other questions? Bill, I want to thank you very much for being here. I want to thank you for leading AmeriCorps. President Clinton's vision, Eli's implementation and vision, but what has happened in 20 years, I think has exceeded any possibilities that people thought about at the time. And I hope that the next 20 years are as good as the first 20. Bill Basl, ladies and gentlemen, the Director of AmeriCorps.